Welcome to the Indo News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. These are the news articles chosen for today's discussion. They are given along with the page number of different editions. Link for the handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping for the discussed articles are given in the description box as well as the comment section for the benefit of the mobile viewers. Now let us take up this image. See, before discussing this image, I want to give some tips regarding prelims. We have approximately 98 days for prelims. So we are entering the crucial phase of preparation. So during this crucial phase, I want to give you some tips which will better your preparation. These tips may be simple, but they are effective. The first important one, revision. See, the last 3 months before prelims should be allotted for revision. Revise a lot. We are studying a lot of information. So in order to retain those information, revision plays a key role. The formula for success is 50% preparation, 50% revision. But many aspirants ignore revision. That is the reason why they are not able to clear prelims. So revise a lot, revise a lot. It will help in retention and it will help in recalling of information. So whenever you can find time, keep on revising. Next important tip is practicing a lot of prelims questions. See, we are studying huge volume of information, but we are not sure how to apply this information. Only through practice of prelims questions, we will know how to apply this information according to civil services exam. So through practice, we can improve our guesses, we can better apply our knowledge, and it will boost our score. In addition to that, practicing a lot of prelims questions will better your elimination technique. It will boost your score, trust me. So whenever you can find time, practice question. Past prelims question paper will be the best source to practice prelims question. So the first important tip is revision. Second one is practicing questions. And the third most important tip is management of stress. Aspirants have to find a way to manage the stress. Otherwise, recollection of information will be a tough job. So management of stress is important for recollecting information. How can we manage stress? Have a proper sleep schedule that will regulate your hormones. It will manage stress. Have proper nutrition. Have some recreational activity will help you to manage stress. And trust me, management of stress is very important to boost your score. With stress, recollection of information gets affected. So sometimes you will make a lot of silly mistakes. So manage your stress. Revision, practicing prelims question, management of stress. These three important points will help you to better your preparations. Now with this knowledge in mind, now let us move on to the picture discussion. Now look at the image. This image is a depiction of Rabar tribal women catching fish from paddy fields or rice fields. See, during monsoon, rice fields of Assam are usually flooded. And from these flooded fields, fishes are caught by Rabar tribal women. This is what depicted in this picture. So in this context, let us learn about paddy fishing or fishing in paddy field. Let us also learn about Rabar tribe very briefly. First, let us see about paddy field fishing. See, paddy fishing is also called as rice fish system. What is paddy fishing? See, paddy fishing is an integrated rice field, or it is a combination of a rice field and a pond complex. It acts both as a rice field as well as a pond. In the system, fishes are grown concurrently with the rice cultivation. Sometimes it is also grown alternately with the rice cultivation. Both kind of cultivations are seen. Fishes grown with rice or fishes grown alternately with rice. How these fishes enter this paddy fields? Sometimes these fishes are deliberately introduced into the paddy fields, or they enter naturally through the surrounding waters when flooding occurs. To put it in simple words, we may deliberately enter the fishes into the paddy field, or the fishes may enter naturally through the flooding process, or it can be a combination of both. So this is the information regarding rice fish system or paddy fish system. See, the beauty of rice fish system is it allows the production of fish and other aquatic animals from the same rice field area without causing reduction in rice yield. So it gives the same rice yield along with production of fishes. This is a great advantage. Now let us discuss the advantages of the system. First important advantage. See, paddy fishing allows fuller utilization of available resource. Next important advantage. Paddy fishing can serve as an off-season occupation for farmers. See, in India, crops are grown seasonally. So this paddy fishing can act as an off-season occupation for the farmers. Third important advantage. The fishes in the paddy fishing act as an excellent agent for integrated pest management, IPM. So paddy fishing will reduce the need to use chemical pesticides. These fishes will act as excellent pest managers. There is no need of chemical pesticides.
Fourth important advantage. See, the introduction of fishes in paddy fishing increases soil productivity, which will boost the production of paddy. This will also lead to soil rejuvenation. This is the fourth important advantage of paddy fishing. Above all, the final important advantage is it will boost productivity and income from a unit area. So it will play a key role in doubling farmers' income. So these are the advantages of paddy fishing. See, paddy fishing can be used as value addition in your mains answer. Sometimes you can expect direct prelims question. Otherwise, you can use it as a value addition in your mains answer when the question is about farmer issues, when the question is about farmers' income. You can use the concept of paddy fishing as value addition. So far, we have discussed about paddy fish cultivation. Now, let us see about Rabar tribes. See, Rabar tribe is one of the scheduled tribes of India. They are found in Assam and West Bengal. Rabar tribes live in small isolated groups. These small isolated groups are called as Rabar Basti. So these are the basic points regarding Rabar tribes. See, according to Indian Journal of Medical Science, HBE, a hemoglobin variant, is found in high incidence among Rabar tribes. If you are from anthropology optional, you can make use of this point. So with this, we have come to the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw about paddy fishing, advantages of paddy fishing, and we saw about Rabar tribe in brief. Now let us move on to the next article. Now look at this article. This article is about a plane crash in Philippines. In this context, let us learn about the geography of Philippines. See, Philippines is one of the world's largest archipelago nations. It is located in the Southeast Asia, in the Western Pacific Ocean. The islands of Philippines are classified into three main geographical areas. The first one is Luzon, second one is Visayas, and third one is Mindanao. Philippines has more than 7,000 islands. The two largest islands are Luzon and Mindanao. They make up 2/3 of the total land area. Out of the 7,000 islands, only 1/3 of the islands are inhabited. Also, it is important to note that Philippines is located near Ring of Fire. So, volcanoes are important part of Philippines. It has more than 50 volcanoes, and out of these 50 volcanoes, only 10 are known to be active. So, these are the important points regarding the geography of Philippines. When you are talking about the climate of Philippines, it is mostly tropical and monsoonal in type. As you can see in the map, Philippines is surrounded by South China Sea to its west and Pacific Ocean to the east. And we all know that South China Sea is one of the world's contentious geographical spaces. So it is important that we learn about South China Sea. Let us discuss about it. Now look at this map of South China Sea for better understanding. As we can see from the map, South China Sea is an arm of, to be specific, it is an arm of Western Pacific Ocean. This is an important point. The South China Sea is bounded on the northeast by the Taiwan Strait. This Taiwan Strait is connected to the East China Sea. So South China Sea is connected to the East China Sea through Taiwan Strait. This is another important point. See, when we're talking about South China Sea, it is bounded by Philippines in the east. We can observe this in the map. South China Sea is bounded on the southeast and south by the coast of Malay Peninsula. And to the west and north of the South China Sea lies the Asian mainland. So these are the important bodies surrounding South China Sea. As I've already discussed, South China Sea is connected to the East China Sea through Taiwan Strait. The South China Sea along with East China Sea is called as China Sea. This is another important point. See, when we are discussing about South China Sea, it is important that we discuss about the contested islands in this region. Paracel Islands, Spratly Islands and Scarborough Shoal. These are the name of the islands which are located in South China Sea. These islands are contested among various nations. Another important feature of South China Sea is the 9 dash line. The 9 dash line is highlighted in red in the map. See, the 9 dash line is located in the South China Sea. What is the 9 dash line? See, 9 dash line is nothing but China's claim in South China Sea. According to the China, the enclosed space within the 9 dash line belongs to China. This enclosed space is rich in oil resources. So China through the 9 dash line is claiming this space. So these are the important points regarding South China Sea. So with this, we have come to the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw about the geography of Philippines. We discussed about the climate of Philippines. We discussed about the volcanoes of Philippines. And we also discussed about the South China Sea. With this, we have come to the end of this discussion. Now let us move on to the next article. Now look at this article. This article is from Sports Column. It is about the Olympic torch relay. So in this context, let us see some important facts about Olympics. Let us also learn about Olympic torch ceremony. First, what is Olympics? See, we all know that Olympic Games is an international sports. It is an international sports festival to be precise. The Olympic Games are held once in every 4 years. And when we are talking about Olympics, both Summer Games and Winter Games are held separately. So these are the important points regarding Olympic Games. When we are talking about the history of Olympics, it can be traced back to 2300 years. However, the first modern Olympic Games were held in 1896. It was held at Athens, Greece. So this is the first official year of modern Olympic Games. See, when you are talking about Olympics, it is important that we learn about International Olympic Committee. What is International Olympic Committee? See, International Olympic Committee is the supreme authority of the Olympic movement. So it is the highest authority when it comes to Olympic Games. It has the responsibility of hosting the games. And when we are talking about hosting responsibility, it is usually given to a city, not a country. This is very important point when it comes to Olympics. The hosting responsibility of Olympics is given to a city, not a country. For example, it is called Tokyo Olympics, not Japan Olympics. This is the key point. So these are the points regarding Olympics. Now let us discuss about Olympic torch relay. What is Olympic torch relay? See, Olympic torch relay is a modern invention inspired by practices from ancient Greece. What is the function of Olympic torch relay? The Olympic torch relay highlights the start of the Olympic Games. It also transmits the message of peace and friendship along its route. This is the main function of Olympic torch relay. The Olympic torch was first used at 1936 Berlin Summer Olympics. This is an important point. It was not used in 1896. It was first time used in 1936. And since then, it continues to be practiced till date. See, the modern torches of the Summer and Winter Olympics are built in a such a way to resist the effects of wind and rain as they carry the Olympic flame. And these torches are designed with unique designs that represents the host country and the spirit of the games. So these are the important points regarding Olympic torch relay. So this is the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw about Olympic Games and we saw about Olympic torch relay. Now let us move on to the next article. Now look at this article. See, according to this article, two-time MLA in Uttarakhand, Mr. Pushkar Singh Dhami, was appointed as the 11th Chief Minister of Uttarakhand. Now in this context, let us discuss about the Office of Chief Minister. See, polity is an important topic for prelims. Last year, 2020, around 20 questions were asked from polity. It is an highly rewarding area. So with this knowledge in mind, let us discuss the Office of Chief Minister. See, in a parliamentary system of government, the governor is the head of the state, while the chief minister is the head of the government. So the position of chief minister is very powerful. Now let us see about the appointment of chief minister. When it comes to the appointment of chief minister, the Constitution of India does not contain any specific procedure. This is a very important point. See, Article 164 of the Constitution only says that chief minister shall be appointed by the governor. However, this does not imply that governor is free to appoint anyone. He has to follow the conventions of parliamentary system of government. So in accordance with the convention, the governor has to appoint the leader of the majority party in the state legislative assembly as the chief minister. This is the convention. But when no party has a clear majority in the assembly election, then the governor may exercise his personal discretion in the appointment of chief minister. In this case, the governor usually appoints the leader of the largest party or coalition in the assembly as the chief minister. So these are the conventions followed by governor while appointment of chief minister. And it is also important to note that governor may first appoint a person as the chief minister and then ask the person to prove majority in the legislative assembly within a reasonable period. This is another important point. Also, a person who is not a member of the state legislature can be appointed as chief minister for 6 months. In the meantime, he or she should be elected to the state legislature. If not, the person ceases to be the chief minister. So these are the important points regarding the appointment of chief minister. Now coming to the tenure of the chief minister. See, theoretically, the chief minister holds office during the pleasure of the governor. However, in actual practice, the chief minister remains in office as long as he or she continues to be the leader of the majority in state legislative assembly. The governor can dismiss the chief minister in case he or she loses the majority support. The state legislative assembly can also remove the chief minister by passing a vote of no confidence. So these are the important points regarding the tenure of chief minister. With this, we have come to the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw about the chief minister's office. Now let us move on to the next discussion. Now look at this editorial. This editorial is regarding the proposed model for integrated theatre command. This topic has been in news recently. It has created a lot of controversy. According to various news sources, the Army and the Navy have agreed to this proposal, whereas the Air Force has not agreed to this proposal. It has certain reservations regarding the Integrated Theater Command. To be specific, the proposed model for Integrated Theater Command. This editorial is a discussion on that. Let us learn about it. The syllabus for reference is displayed on the screen. Aspirants can go through it. See, before discussing this editorial, first let us see about Integrated Theater Command. What is Integrated Theater Command? To put it in simple words, Integrated Theater Command is a unified command. It is a unified command under which all the resources of Army, Navy, and Air Force are put together. To put it in simple words, it is an area in which all the three forces of defenses work together. This is a simple explanation for Integrated Theater Command. So currently, a model has been proposed regarding Integrated Theater Command. What is the model? See, according to the proposed model, there will be 4 to 5 Integrated Tri-Services Theater Command in India. These commands will be headed by a 3-star officer. This is the proposal under consideration. And as we have already discussed, the Army and Navy have agreed to this proposal, whereas Indian Air Force is opposing this proposal. Now let us see why Indian Air Force is opposing such a proposal. What are the reasons behind its opposition? The first main reason. See, the Indian Air Force feels that the air power is being seen as a supplement force or secondary force to Army and Navy. This is the main reason why Indian Air Force has objected the current proposal of Integrated Theater Command. It feels that it is being secondary to other forces like Army and Navy. So Indian Air Force wants a model of Integrated Theater Command where it will be treated as equal. Another reason for the objection is the Air Force is worried that 4 to 5 Integrated Theater Command will divide the Air Force into small units. This will seriously degrade the effectiveness of air operations. So this is another reason why IFS is opposing such a proposal. The first reason is IFS is seen as a supplement or secondary force. The second reason is IFS will be divided into small units. So these are the two reasons why Indian Air Force is opposing such a proposal. How can we overcome this opposition? See, the author of the editorial gives few suggestions to overcome this opposition. Let us see it one by one. What are the suggestions given by the author of the editorial for effective implementation of Integrated Theater Command? The first suggestion, proper national security strategy. See, India got independence in 1947. It has been over 7 decades. Even after 7 decades, India still does not have a clearly articulated national security strategy. A proper national security strategy will ensure coordinated operations among the defense forces. It will also increase communications among the defense forces. Increased coordination and communication will build the trust of Indian Air Force. This will lead to proper implementation of Integrated Theater Command. So this is the first suggestion given by the author. Clearly articulated national security strategy. Such a strategy will reduce the duplication of efforts. It will decrease wasting of resources. So it is essential for effective implementation of Integrated Theater Command. See, according to the author of the editorial, framing a national security strategy will build trust among various defense forces. This is essential for effective implementation of Integrated Theater Command. Second suggestion given by the author is the requirement of effective communication and sharing of information. The author of the editorial stresses this point by citing an example. See, during the 1999 Kargil War, Indian Army did not communicate full information to the Indian Air Force. This led to a lot of problems. This also made Indian Air Force left alone while carrying out military operations. This incident also led to lack of trust in Indian Air Force. So by having a proper requirement of effective communication and sharing of information, this hurdle can be overcome. It will ensure proper communication among the defense forces. It will increase the trust among the defense forces. This will lead to effective implementation of Integrated Theater Command. So these are the suggestions given by the author for effective implementation of Integrated Theater Command. First suggestion is national security strategy. Second suggestion is requirement of effective communication and sharing of information. With this, we have come to the end of this discussion. In this discussion, we saw about Integrated Theater Command, why Indian Air Force is opposing the proposed model for Integrated Theater Command, and what are suggestions which can overcome such objections and lead to effective implementation of Integrated Theater Command. Now let us move on to the next article. Now let us take up this article. This article is regarding Nipun Bharat, NIPUN Bharat. See, the abbreviation Nipun stands for National Initiative for Proficiency in Reading with Understanding and Numeracy. So this is the expansion of Nipun. Now let us discuss about Nipun Bharat in detail. See, Nipun Bharat was launched by Department of School Education and Literacy. This department is under Ministry of Education. See, Nipun Bharat was launched by the department for successful implementation of National Education Policy 2020. What is the vision of Nipun Bharat? See, the vision of Nipun Bharat is to create an enabling environment which ensures that every child achieves their desired learning competencies in reading, writing and numeracy by the end of grade 3. This has to be achieved by 2026 to 2027. This is the vision of Nipun Bharat Mission. To put it in simple words, Nipun Bharat Mission aims to achieve the basic skill of reading, writing, numeracy by the end of 3rd standard. This is the simple explanation for Nipun Bharat Mission. See, the Nipun Bharat Mission will come under the centrally sponsored scheme Samagra Siksha. Nipun Bharat Mission has 5-tier implementation mechanism. This 5-tier implementation mechanism will be set up at national level, state level, district level, block level and school level in all states and union territories. This is important point. Nipun Bharat Mission is likely to emphasize goal setting and accountability for state governments. It will also provide guidelines for teacher training, assessment and creation of printed resources. See, we have already discussed that Nipun Bharat Mission is an important part of National Education Policy 2020. See, according to National Education Policy 2020, we should achieve universal foundational literacy and numeracy in primary school by 2025. This was the initial goal. But now, this target has been pushed to 2026 to 2027. This is due to academic disruption caused by COVID-19. So these are the important points discussed in the article. We can expect Nipun Bharat Mission question in upcoming prelims. So make sure you have basic understanding about this mission. With this, we have come to the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw about Nipun Bharat Mission, its department and ministry, its vision and its functions and features. Now let us move on to the next discussion. Now let us take up this editorial. See, recently, the Ministry of Commerce and Industry revealed its achievements for the period April to June of 2021 to 2022. April to June is the first quarter of a financial year. So the ministry has revealed its achievements for the first quarter of this financial year. This editorial is an analysis on those achievements. Let us learn about it. The syllabus for reference is displayed on the screen. Aspirants can go through it. See, according to the ministry, the merchandise export during this period was $95 billion. This is the major achievement highlighted by the ministry. According to the author of the editorial, $95 billion in terms of merchandise export is not a small feat. It is a huge achievement. It is a phenomenal growth of exports. And this phenomenal growth in export was not achieved easily. See, during the first quarter of this financial year, we experienced a lot of hurdles. For example, during this quarter, the second wave of the COVID pandemic hit its peak. So in order to control the infection spread, we imposed lockdowns across various regions in India. These lockdowns should have affected our exports, but it was not the case. This is because we took some proactive steps to increase exports from India. For example, we took sector-specific interventions, we involved all the stakeholders, we improved the functioning of the government, we simplified a lot of procedures, we extended a lot of timelines and licenses. So these proactive steps helped us to increase export during this period. In addition to all these factors, there is also another major reason why exported increased during this period. See, in the world scenario, the vaccination coverage is on the rise. And because of the increased vaccination coverage, many crucial economies are recovering. For example, European Union and United States of America are recovering because of rising vaccination coverages. These economic recoveries also boosted our trade. All these factors helped India to achieve the magic number of $95 billion during this period in terms of merchandise export. This is highlighted by the article. See, this phenomenal growth in export, it is better than other developed economies. For example, India did better than European Union. India did better than Japan, USA, Korea and United Kingdom during this period in terms of exports. So when it comes to exports, we are doing better than some of the major economies of the world. We also received a lot of FDI during this period. The FDA number for the first quarter of financial year 2021 was $81.72 billion. This number is better than other major economies of the world. So it may seem that we are doing better than other major economies of the world, but that is not the case. See, the present increase in export is due to the reopening of major economies. That was a major factor. So this will not be the case forever. See, India set an ambitious target of $400 billion merchandise export in 2021 to 2022. This is a huge target. So in order to achieve this huge target, according to the author of the editorial, we have to restore health of every constituent sector. We should not rely on short-term factors. Instead of all those things, we should restore the health of every constituent sectors of India. Only by restoring each and every sector in India, we can achieve this ambitious target of $400 billion. This is highlighted by the editorial. The author stresses this point by highlighting some examples. For example, let us take the sectors of ready-made garments, leather, leather products and tea. The export from these sectors declined during the first quarter of this financial year. See, in spite of increase in exports during the first quarter of financial year, these sectors saw decline in exports. This shows that we have deep structural problem in our economy. So only by resolving these deeper structural problems, we can achieve the ambitious target of $400 billion. So these are the points highlighted by the editorial. We have come to the end of this discussion. In this discussion, we saw about the achievements of Commerce Ministry during the first quarter of 2021. We saw the reasons behind it. We also discussed about the ambitious target of India when it comes to exports and how we can achieve it. Now let us move on to the next discussion. Now let us take up this article. See, the news mentioned in this article is not important, but this article mentions about National Green Tribunal. So in this context, let us discuss about National Green Tribunal from prelims perspective. See, the National Green Tribunal or NGT has been established under the National Green Tribunal Act 2010. What is the purpose of NGT? See, the purpose of NGT is for effective and speedy disposal of cases relating to environmental protection and conservation of forest and other natural resources. This is the main purpose of NGT. In addition to that, NGT also deals with matters relating to enforcement of any legal right relating to the environment. The tribunal also gives relief and compensation for damages to persons and property. So these are the main purpose and objectives of NGT. Now let us see about its composition. See, currently the sanction strength of NGT is 10 expert members and 10 judicial members. The NGT Act allows a maximum of 20 members in each category. So the total strength of NGT can be 40, but currently it has only 20 members. 10 expert members and 10 judicial members. See, the chairman of the NGT is the administrative head of the tribunal. He also serves as judicial member of NGT. What is the eligibility condition for the office of chairman of NGT? See, the chairman of NGT should be serving or retired Chief Justice of High Court or Judge of Supreme Court of India. Let me repeat, the chairman of NGT should be a serving or retired Chief Justice of High Court or a Judge of the Supreme Court of India. So this is the eligibility condition for office of chairman of NGT. See, the members of NGT are chosen by a selection committee. This selection committee reviews their application and conducts interviews. The selection committee is headed by a sitting judge of the Supreme Court of India. So these are the important points regarding the composition of NGT. With this information in mind, now let us see some important facts regarding NGT. The first important fact. See, the National Green Tribunal is not bound by the procedure laid down under the Code of Civil Procedure 1908. This is the first important point. It is not bound by Code of Civil Procedure. Instead, it is guided by principles of natural justice. See, this point is very important. Usually many people make mistakes in this point. The National Green Tribunal is guided by principles of natural justice. It is not bound by Code of Civil Procedure 1908. Next important point. The tribunal is mandated to dispose application or appeal within 6 months of filing. This ensures speedy disposal of cases. So any application or appeal, the tribunal must dispose it within 6 months. This is the second important point. The third important fact. See, the tribunal's dedicated jurisdiction in environmental matters provides speedy environmental justice, which has reduced the burden of litigation in high courts. This is the third important fact. See, previously there were a lot of environmental litigation in higher courts. Now the tribunal has dedicated jurisdiction in environmental matters. So it has taken a lot of burden off higher courts. So these are the important facts regarding National Green Tribunal. With this, we have come to the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw about National Green Tribunal, the purpose of National Green Tribunal, the objectives of National Green Tribunal, the composition of National Green Tribunal, and some important facts regarding National Green Tribunal. Now let us move on to the next discussion. See, the next article is regarding HIV. We have discussed about HIV in detail in our June 29th Indo News analysis. Interested aspirants can go through that video. Now let us move on to the next article. See, the next article is regarding UAV or drones. Again, we have discussed about drones in detail in our June 17th video. Interested aspirants can go through June 17th daily news analysis for better understanding. Now let us move on to practice prelims question. First question. Consider the following statements. First statement. Constitution does not contain any specific procedure for the appointment of Chief Minister. Second statement. Chief Minister should be a member of the legislature at the time of appointment. Which of the above statements are correct? A. 1 only. B. 2 only. C. Both 1 and 2. D. Neither 1 nor 2. C. The first statement is correct. The Constitution does not contain any specific procedure for the appointment of Chief Minister. It simply says Governor will appoint the Chief Minister. So, first statement is correct. Moving to the second statement. See, second statement is incorrect. See, a person who is not a member of the state legislature can be appointed as Chief Minister for 6 months. Within the 6 months, the Chief Minister should be elected to the state legislature. Otherwise, he or she ceases to be the Chief Minister. So, second statement is incorrect. Chief Minister shall not be a member of legislature during his or her appointment. So, first statement is correct. Second statement is incorrect. The answer is A, 1 only. Now, moving to the second question. Rabar tribes, who are commonly seen in news, inhabit which of the following areas? A, Assam. B, Himachal Pradesh. C, Rajasthan. D, Odisha. See, as we discussed in the article, Rabar tribes commonly are seen in Assam and West Bengal. So, the correct answer is A, Assam. Now, moving on to the third question. Arrange the following geographical features from north to south. 1. Taiwan Strait. 2. Japan. 3. South China Sea. 4. Indonesia. Select from the quotes given below. A. 1243. B. 2143. C. 2134. D. 1234. See, the correct answer is C. 2134. First comes the Japan. Next comes Taiwan Strait. Third comes South China Sea. And finally comes Indonesia. This is the order from north to south. The correct answer is 2134. Now moving on to the fourth question. The National Green Tribunal has jurisdiction over the which of the following acts? 1. The Air Prevention and Control of Pollution Act 1981, the Environment Protection Act 1986, the Public Liability Insurance Act 1991, the Biological Diversity Act 2002. Select the correct answer from the following quotes. A. 1 and 2 only. B. 1, 2 and 4 only. C. 2 and 4 only. D. 1, 2, 3 and 4. See, the National Green Tribunal has jurisdiction over 7 laws. The first law is Water Act Prevention and Control of Pollution 1974. Second law, Water Cess Act Prevention and Control of Pollution 1977. Third law, Forest Act Conservation 1980. Fourth law, Air Act Prevention and Control of Pollution 1981. Fifth law, Environment Protection Act 1986. Sixth law, Public Liability Insurance Act 1991. Seventh act, Biological Diversity Act 2002. So all the four acts mentioned in the question comes under the jurisdiction of National Green Tribunal. So the answer is D, 1, 2, 3 and 4. Now moving on to the fifth question. Consider the following statements regarding Nipun Bharat Mission. First statement. It aims to create an enabling environment to ensure universal acquisition of foundational literacy and numeracy by 2050. Second statement, it will be implemented by the Department of School Education and Literacy, Ministry of Education. Which of the statements given above are correct? A. 1 only. B. 2 only. C. Both 1 and 2. D. Neither 1 nor 2. Now let us take the first statement. See, the first statement is incorrect. See, Nipun Bharat Mission aims to create an enabling environment to ensure universal acquisition of foundation literacy and numeracy. This part is correct. But it aims to create by 2026, not 2050. So, first statement is incorrect. Moving on to the second statement. From the discussion of the article, we know second statement is correct. Nipun Bharat Mission is implemented by Department of School Education and Literacy, which comes under Ministry of Education. So, the answer is option B, 2 only. mains practice questions are displayed here. You can write your answer and post in the comment section below. With this, we have come to the end of the news analysis. If you like the video, click like, comment and subscribe. Thank you.